Hello everyone, and welcome to another episode of the Council of Elrond. In this episode, I'm going to talk about the similarities, the symbolism, and the parallels between our world and Tolkien's Middle-earth. We are going to discuss some things that inspired Professor Tolkien as far as culture and themes are concerned, and also some things that inspired Peter Jackson when he worked on his trilogy in terms of costumes, architecture, and imagery. I'm sure you will come away having learned something new, and hopefully we'll have a bit of a laugh and some fun along the way. I am your host Dave, and with me is my co-host and fellow Mellon Head, Johnny.
Symbolmuna, ever has it grown on the tombs of my forebears.
Tolkien kind of contradicts himself as he once said, "I cordially dislike allegory in all forms," but he also has said that some cultures in his Middle-earth were inspired. Most things in anyone's imagination are inspired whether they know it or not, in my opinion. I'm going to mostly talk about Rohan and Gondor, but I'm going to also touch on some other factions and aspects of Lord of the Rings as well. So Rohan, to begin, they're based on Anglo-Saxon style. The white horse on green backdrop banner may be based off the Uffington horse built 3,000 years ago in Oxfordshire in England. I don't know if you've ever seen it. It's like a big white horse kind of carved into the side of a mountainside with chalk and rock. It's kind of cool.
Not too sure if I've seen that.
Yeah, no, it's like this ancient thing. It's kind of like Roundstone. What was it called?
Roundstone, County Sligo.
Roundstone, County Sligo.
Stonehenge.
That's it.
I thought you were talking about Newgrange.
Oh yeah, Newgrange, Stonehenge.
What's the meaning of Stonehenge?
But lots of Saxons and Germanic people use the white horse as banners also, so this was like a really big inspiration for Rohan. Rohirrim are basically a mix of Anglo-Saxons with their culture and their aesthetic, and the Normans with their cavalry and their stone castles, because Helm's Deep obviously wouldn't be a very Anglo-Saxon style place.
Yeah.
But when you come down to even the names like Théoden, it actually derives from Old English meaning leader. And also the fact that he is referred to as Théoden King a lot in the books is similar to renderings in Old English and Old Norse. For example, Alfred the Great is known as Alfred Cooning or Alfred King. So there are many similarities between Théoden and Beowulf, actually. Him being an elderly legend of a king and not wanting to ride to war anymore, but accepts his fate to die in battle, just like Beowulf accepts his fate to die fighting the dragon. So lots of similarities there.
My wolf who was my bae. My bae wolf.
My bae wolf.
When you said something about Helm's Deep there, were you saying, because I'm just trying to remember, was Helm's Deep built by the Rohirrim or was that built by Gondor?
Ooh, good question. Now that you mention it, I feel like it wasn't, but like when I was researching it, they mentioned Helm's Deep as like a Rohan fortress and... I don't know, but it might have been like a Numenor structure.
I can't remember. It's just that's just come to my head now. And maybe as something like it could have been an old fortress that was created. Like, you know, obviously Gondor back in the day went around building loads of stuff like Isengard and
yeah.
This could be all wrong. I'm just like totally
no, but no, but you could be all right. And I know when I was watching,
I am all right.
The behind the scenes of Middle Earth, or like designing Middle Earth, they called it. They wanted to kind of have an aesthetic in Lord of the Rings where there was like ancient history before the time that they're showing on screen, which is pretty cool. So they had to, like Amon Hen, they had to like have like ancient ruin there, but the ruin was of a different style than buildings are designed now. So it's pretty incredible how they did all that.
It's cool.
But anyways.
But anywho.
Also, Rohirrim names are derived from Old English. So lots of characters from Rohan have horse in their name, as horses are such an important part of their culture.
Well, horse. How's it going, horse?
That's a Irish slang, in case anyone's wondering. Eowyn, which is Eo, is horse in Old English, and Win is joy, so it translates to horse joy or joyful horse.
Class.
Also, Eomer meaning famous, would be famous horse,
like Sea Biscuit or something like that.
Yeah, exactly. Eomer was like Sea Biscuit.
He was a very famous horse.
And some other words are just like directly just taken from Old English words as well, like Edoras is Old English for enclosures, Ridder is Old English for knight, and Mark is Old English for borderland. So kind of similar to you know, Denmark, the country, is actually translates to border of the Danes.
Oh, class.
Yeah, so Riddermark is the borderland of knights.
Oh, man. I've so much more respect for Denmark now.
Yeah, me too.
The Danes of the Mark.
The Denmark. Many other names, such as Théoden, Helm, Errol, Gamling, Théodred, Hama, Grimbald, have just been lifted straight from old sagas and stories, and some just have very Germanic formulas as well. So that's basically where Tolkien got all his inspiration, was these Germanic stories and old Anglo-Saxon things. But of course, Jackson's design team also went for the Saxon and Viking style in his movies, because it's quite noticeable. They don't have horns, though, but...
Who don't have horns? Oh, sorry. I thought you meant like trumpet horns.
Oh, they have those horns.
Like the Horn of Gondor. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So when you said they don't have horns, I was thinking, what? Sorry, I'm just confused. I got confused by your horn.
Blowing my own trumpet.
I've had confusing horns before.
The Horn of Gondor.
But moving on to Gondor, Tolkien referred to Minas Tirith as, quote, a Byzantine city, and it draws some similarities to the Byzantine Empire. For example, the last Byzantine emperor, Constantine the 11th, remained in legend as the Marble King, whose messianic resurrection and return would restore signal and restoration of the empire. Similarly to whom?
I've no idea what you just said. Marble King, Byzantine, what?
Have you heard of the Byzantine Empire, no?
No.
Have you not?
I'm an idiot. I don't know any empires or... I don't know, I'm just... I hear these things and I just completely think, oh, that's cool, and then I immediately forget them.
So, have you heard of the Ottoman Empire?
I've heard of the Ottoman Empire, yes.
All right. Ottoman is where you put your feet on when you're lying down or sitting on a chair.
Yeah, if you ask me anything else about the Ottoman Empire, apart from just the name, I don't even know if I'm pronouncing the name correctly, so I don't know anything about them at all. So
Ottoman.
I'm the kind of person that doesn't remember any facts about actual real life history, but I'll remember loads of like really unimportant things about Lord of the Rings history.
I'll remember who Aragorn's great-great-granduncle is.
Yeah, just speaking of remembering things, I think I'm just remembering now that like when I said before about Helm's Deep, I'm pretty sure it was built by Gondor, and I think it was like Gondor and the Dúnedain who built like Isengard. So there you go. That's the kind of things that I'll remember, but I won't remember anything about real life history.
Yeah, I definitely remember hearing Isengard was built. It was like a Gondorian structure, all right. Mm. But cool. But that would be similar to Aragorn's return, the whole messianic resurrection and return of to restore the empire. Also, beacons were used in the Byzantine Empire, so that was a direct inspiration.
I wonder if they were as glorious in the Byzantine, the beacons, as they were in the Howard Shore time.
Yeah, did Howard Shore accompany the Byzantine Empire when he was...
I think when you light a beacon, it just starts to play Howard Shore music from the inside. Yeah. The combination of the burning and the coal and the wood and the hay just starts to give a Howard Shore vibe.
I wonder what the script said for that scene. Was it just supposed to be as epic as it was? Or was it supposed to be a bunch of beacons just got lit? Maybe they misinterpreted it for this scene was lit and then... They just had to put in some awesome music.
Yeah, lit AF. Actually, I'm gonna take this moment to shout out a video that I was watching on YouTube by a YouTube page called Listening In, and it's one of the coolest things that I've seen on YouTube in a long, long time. It's basically a guy who breaks down the music in certain films, and I've watched a few videos he's done on like Star Wars and looking at John Williams, and he does Howard Shore in the Lord of the Rings, and he does. He gives you all the like if you know your music theory, you're going to understand everything he's talking about. But he also kind of explains it in a way that if you don't really know a lot about music theory, you're still going to have a good idea of what he's talking about. But cool. It just shows how Howard Shore kind of layers his music. And he gives one of the examples that he gives is obviously the lighting of the beacons, because the music in that scene is incredible.
Yeah.
And it's really intentionally done. So if you're thinking, was it supposed to be that epic? Yes, it was definitely supposed to be that epic. And Howard Shore had a vision for what he was doing, and he did it like so well. So I definitely recommend checking out that page. I don't know what the guy's name is, but the name of his page is called Listening In on YouTube. So go check that out.
Sweet. Yeah, cool. I definitely will check that out. But that's cool to know. And it's cool to shout that out.
Exactly. I was like, I want to start shouting people out and just like...
I actually have a shout out in this video too, or this thing as well.
Okay.
Wait, I'm going to bet that it's the Jewel of the Fates. Is it the John Williams one?
Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah. Right. Well, he, I think he opens up talking about that when he starts saying how, like, Duel of the Fates is the probably the only other one by John Williams in the Lord of the Ring, or in the Star Wars franchise, which was like accepted as like to be as high of a standard as like a lot of the stuff that was in the original sequels, like by the like, you know, the by the main Star Wars like mega nerds that were massive fans of the original series, yeah. And then they hated the prequels. They still were like, but that song is epic,
like, and that whole like fight and everything is oh, epic, man, about
it's
it.
So good, yeah. Actually, the Star Wars one, I watched it all as well. Like the Lord of the Rings video that he does, that you should check out. I think it's about 10 minutes or so. I think the Star Wars one is about 25 minutes, but it's worth watching as well. He goes maybe a little bit into too much music theory detail, and it's so like over the top. I couldn't follow it at all. Like as in, I could follow a lot of it when he's talking about like intervals and all these different types of things, but he goes like way into it, and I was like, Jesus, this is a bit much. But like the first at least 15 minutes of the video are class when he's talking about like how he's building the from that that song.
Totally.
But yeah, anyway, back to the show.
In the films, the architecture of Minas Tirith pillars and archways also took inspiration from Italy and other Mediterranean countries. Gondor was meant to be like the Rome of Middle-earth. And Peter Jackson also based Minas Tirith on Mount St. Michel in France, which if you see in pictures of it, it's pretty cool. It's kind of like a layered like Minas Tirith. So it's got, I don't know, about four different stories to it.
That's really cool because obviously there's a lot of places in Italy and like where we've been in Cinque Terre, it's kind of like little towns built on the sides of kind of cliffs where they're kind of like layered and all that coastline. Near Tuscany in that area.
Yeah, I never thought about that before. Actually, Cinque Terre is very like Minas Tirith in a way.
Yeah, it just doesn't have the like big white rock, which would also be, you know, as in when you were saying as well with Minas Tirith being modeled on kind of like Rome or whatever.
Mm.
That's really cool because when you're in Rome and you see those kind of like white pillars and the white rock and all that kind of stuff as well, it's like that's really interesting. I didn't know that at all. That's really cool.
Yeah, you can really see the similarities. Like, and again, the statues around Minas Tirith are very Italian, including, I don't know if you notice in the gate for Minas Tirith, there's actually like statues built into the gates, and it's very very Italian style.
Yeah, and there's, do you know, in Madrid as well, in Toledo, there's where you've been a few times before, where we've both been before a few times, they have a lot of, it's a really, really old town, and they have a load of like cathedrals where the doors as well have loads of carvings and statues like built into the door itself as well. So that's like really similar to a lot of Spanish architecture as well, and Italian, I suppose.
Yeah, because I didn't really notice that until I went back and watched the behind the scenes of Minas Tirith. I mean, I probably noticed it, but when you see it up and close and the people actually sculpting the statues in the gate, it's really something
the attention to detail in that in the creation of the sets is incredible. And like you said, when where you can see the similarities with certain things in the real world, it just makes those sets feel so alive and feel so real and true to life.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. The amount of stuff that they didn't even use, or they did use, but they like built and they put that in behind something that's never seen. And they're like, oh, this is just for the kind of authenticity and the feel. And, you know, like if you were to buy a model, you would know that it's real and it's ridiculous. But they based the layout of the courtyards in Minas Tirith on Sierra, Italy, where around each corner there would be like different guilds. So this is actually real on the set of Minas Tirith, even though you didn't see any of it in the movie. But like if you were to walk down the set of Minas Tirith, there'd be blacksmiths on one corner, metalworks on another. And they even had the famous like rat catcher shop, which was some guy who just like,
what? Really?
I think they kind of put it in as a joke. And then they ended up kind of going, well, if you lived in Minas Tirith, there probably would be a rat catcher. So they had a little rat catcher shop. It wasn't even like shown in the movies, but it's in the behind the scenes. It's so detailed. It's incredible.
Was the rat catcher a cat?
It was Smog. No, it was just some old dude like who had a bunch of rats just like hanging out the front of his shop. Like, I don't know, did he want to sell them as well? Denethor's Hall as well was based on Charlemagne's chapel. So there's lots of similarities there with the black marble and the white pillars and all that kind of cold looking chapel. And like I said, a lot of these details weren't even looked at in the film, but they were just background pieces. So absolutely incredible.
Yeah, actually, Denethor's Hall really reminds me of the Pantheon in Rome, which is this like big, huge, it's kind of like a circular building that has an entrance with these huge, big pillars as well. But inside, it's got all like this marble and it's just very grand and kingly inside as well, which is kind of, I know Denethor's Hall isn't circular, but I don't know, just kind
of it is grand.
Inside, it is very grand. You just walk inside, you get this feeling of like, wow, this is like an epic hall.
Yeah.
The courtesy of your hall is somewhat lessened of late.
So also we have the hobbits. So I'm just going to briefly touch on this. The word hobbit derives from, I don't know how to pronounce this now, Hulbulta, which is Old English for hole dweller. And hobbits are also loosely based on Anglo-Saxons, but mainly based on Irish or Victorian English countryside folk, with their comparisons with quiet life, drinking, gardening, and community-style culture.
I like the way drinking was the top of the list there.
I think I kind of made up those comparisons, but like, that's definitely what the comparisons are.
Yeah, what about smoking pipes?
Oh yeah, smoking the old ganja. It's very Irish countryside style.
Old Toby.
Old Toby, the finest weed in the South Valley.
I've one or two for you to guess. So we have the hobbits being compared to Irish countryside, whatnot. We've got Rohan being compared to Anglo-Saxons. Then we have Gondor, kind of more Byzantine, even Egyptian. I didn't mention that earlier, but like with their grand statues and monuments, it's kind of like Egyptian style. But what would you think Tolkien based the dwarves off, would you know?
I don't know. Definitely... some kind of a sturdy, strong people. I could see other kind of Nordic qualities in the dwarves as well. They're just obviously, I mean, we don't have any race of people on Earth that are just like, you know, that are dwarves that are short. So I would kind of, I'd probably rule that, like the height factor, I'd probably rule that out. But I'd definitely say maybe sort of like the kind of Viking sort of type of peoples as well. That's what I would guess, but I've no idea.
Yeah. No, you're completely correct with like Viking, Norse gods, all that kind of stuff. But interestingly, Tolkien also admitted that he thought of the dwarves as Jews, a displaced people living in other lands, speaking their own language to each other. And in fact, given the stereotype of greedy Jews and dwarves, a Nazi sympathizer once tried to sound Tolkien out on anti-Semitism, but Tolkien was having none of it. So he kind of won that little battle, but yeah, there you go. He kind of thought of them as Jews, and I don't know, he didn't mean it as an insult, but that's just how he felt when he was writing the dwarves.
Yeah, that's cool. Again, just anytime I hear these little backstories of this is where this came from, it's like it never fails to like add a little bit more depth to those kind of characters, and where you think like, wow, Tolkien actually had so many thoughts that were like important to the background of these characters.
Yeah,
it's not just like
not just made up on the spot.
If I'm going to try and make up a story about something, I just kind of go, so I'm going to imagine there's these little types of creatures, and they're probably this and this and this, and I'll leave it at that. Whereas he's like, he looks into like the history of them, maybe the religion of them, where they're coming from, what social aspects it's going to affect them, where they're like, we feel displaced and we feel like our history is being lost, and we want to keep that by speaking our own language, and just to like, I don't know, just the social behaviors that are involved in all of these factors from their deep history. So it's so crazy how much detail and how much thought went into like every tiny little detail.
Yeah, and it's not just the aesthetic of certain races. It's even like the way, like you've mentioned, like the way that they were socially and culturally impacted. But I've got one or two more easier ones for you. They're easy for me because I have the answers, but
I'm sweating over here.
So Harad, the Haradrim, who do you think they would be based on? This one's not as complicated. It's not like a misplaced people. It's just like straight up in your face.
I don't know. Maybe kind of the Japanese, kind of getting sort of Japanesey vibe off them. I don't know. Great bunch of lads.
Elephants.
Hang on. All right. Okay. Okay, Indians.
You're getting closer.
Am I?
Yeah. You're still in the wrong continent, though.
Am I? Oh, crap.
So,
Australians.
G'day, Sauron.
People from Antarctica? I've no idea. Which continent?
So, we have elephants, black people, living in deserts and joining their invaders. So, they're Africans, basically.
Africa. Right, yeah. Okay. I suppose, yeah. I mean, I don't know why when you said elephants, I was like, of course, Indian elephants, you know.
Of course, France. Ah, they're from the zoo. Oh, the Haradrim are zoo men. Zookeepers.
Zookeepers, yeah, yeah. They train those Mumukul well.
So we also have Rune. So Easterlings, who do you think they would be based on?
I don't know. If I take Easterlings quite literally from the East, probably more Asian, I don't know, an Asian tribe. So then, I don't know, the Chinese or the, I don't know, somewhere from there.
Yeah, well, from the East, correct, but they were taking inspiration from Persia. So similar to like Persians and the Persian army and all that
yeah,
jazz.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah, definitely. That's cool.
Finally, I think you might know this one. Where did Tolkien get inspiration for Beren and Luthien?
Oh, man. I've definitely read this before. I don't know. Where?
Yeah, you do.
Flip's sake. This is annoying. I want to get this one. Well, he got... I know that he modeled him and his wife's relationship on Beren and Luthien, didn't he? And I know yes. that... Isn't it true that... Is that the answer?
Yeah.
All right.
Keep
okay,
going.
Okay,
I feel like I'm getting the answer out of you. That is the answer, but I just want to keep your train of thought going.
Okay, I know, because also I know that isn't it true that on his gravestone, or on where they are both buried, Tolkien and his wife, that they have like inscribed on the gravestone something to do with Beren and Luthien, like as in they were the two characters that were it was almost like the grave of Beren and Luthien where they were buried.
Yeah, well done. I actually think I should have pulled up the quote, but they have some inscription on the grave, something to do with like mortal man with some immortal angelic lover, but basically he based his relationship with his wife Edith on Beren and Luthien, because I think actually when they first fell in love, Tolkien was like 16 and she was like way older, so they had to like wait until
she
was
3000.
Exactly, she was way too old, so they had to wait a little while.
Okay, yeah, no, I knew that. All right, I thought when you asked me, I thought you were asking me more about like where were individually Beren and Luthien? Were they like on Nordic or Celtic or whatever?
No, sorry. That might have been a bit confusing.
So I was like,
they're from space.
But anyway, yeah.
We're not having no fun till we've had a breather.
So finally, I have other parallels. So first of all, World War One. J.R.R. Tolkien's grandson, Simon Tolkien, talked about how the experience as a soldier in World War One has connections with elves and men against unforeseen evil. The industrial machines Saruman and Sauron used to equip their armies are comparable to the lethal technological advances made throughout the war. He also noted that the camaraderie between soldiers forced to spend days and nights in close proximity is similar to how the four main hobbits are represented. Also, Frodo's inability to return to everyday life after his experience in Mordor is a bit of a reflection on how veterans struggle to assimilate back to reality, I suppose, and civilization after the war.
Yeah, that's cool. So Frodo's got like some serious PTSD.
Yeah,
he needs to work through that in the Undying Lands.
Yeah, in the Dying Lands. Like Tolkien kind of said, you know, he didn't take inspiration from wars and such, but it's kind of clear for some people to see. Again, the Dead Marshes, the Mines of Moria, they're depicted very much like recorded descriptions of World War One trenches.
I think when Tolkien says that he didn't like get his inspiration from World War One or from that kind of a situation, I think what he's trying to do is not say that like that's not the main inspiration for the entire story. But of course, if there's battle scenes and if there's the horror of war in the Lord of the Rings world, well, then obviously he's going to draw from his own ideas of war, where he's got a better idea of war than anybody else or than like most of us alive today.
Exactly. You rascals! I just have a quote here that I'm going to read out for you now. Almost impossible to traverse and haunted by lingering faces in the gloom. So that description of the World War One trenches is very similar to how Tolkien describes the Dead Marshes. And it was also noted that Tolkien's first stories of dragons came shortly after the introduction of tanks to war. So coinkydink? I think not.
Well, that's good news.
I just want to give one of our listeners a shout out as well, Ben Pates, I think. I don't know if I'm pronouncing your surname right, but he reached out on Twitter and informed me on this, that the One Ring is actually based on a Roman ring with a Latin inscription on it that Tolkien studied. I thought that was really cool. So thanks, wow. Ben, for that. But I also found that some people think that Tolkien took inspiration for the One Ring from a nuclear bomb, which is also pretty dope.
Yeah, that's cool. That's very, very cool. So do we actually know exactly which is the correct inspiration? No. Or is there a kind of lots of different possibilities?
I think it's just possibilities. People probably were like, oh my God, Tolkien went to that museum that had that ring. Maybe that's where he came up with the Lord of the Rings, you know? So
yeah,
it's hard to know. Like he never said anything himself. It's just people trying to put the pieces together. But
sure. Or else, yeah. Again, as always, if any of our listeners know, which most of them probably know more than us, if they know anything about this exact situation about where Tolkien got the inspiration for, particularly for the One Ring, we'd love to know about that. So let us know. Well, obviously, thank you to Ben for that that comment that he sent in, and if that's the true thing, that's really cool as well.
Yeah, thanks, Ben. We love you. Of course, it is well known that there is a lot of Christian symbolism within all the Tolkien's works, but I'm not going to bore you on that. Such as Gandalf's similar traits to Jesus and longing for the return of the king, like Christians awaiting for Christ to return. And the fact that Aragorn looks like Jesus as well. Massive, massive symbolism there.
He's got that Jesus glow about him, doesn't he?
Yeah.
He's got that L'Oreal hair when he's getting crowned.
You're worth it, Aragorn. Before we finish, I just wanted to touch on the movies really quickly. So first of all, if you haven't watched the behind the scenes of Lord of the Rings, we have discussed it briefly on this episode. But even if you're just a fan of filmmaking in general, please go watch that as quickly as possible as you can, because it's incredible the amount of time, effort, attention to detail that they put into these movies. Just the camera tricks and inventive way they shot things hasn't been seen in any movie before or since, in my opinion. I don't know. I've seen loads of behind the scenes of movies, and you know, usually it might be like a 30-minute extra on a DVD, but this is like, what, 3 extra DVDs or 2 extra DVDs for each movie?
It's insane the amount of extras that they actually give you to watch, and you know that so much of it didn't even make it into the DVDs as well.
Yeah.
So and as we spoke about earlier in the podcast, just the attention to detail is insane. Like just where, like you said, the little types of extra shops and kind of
the rat catchers,
types of occupations that existed back then, and they like just were considering the possibilities of what types of occupations could exist in that sort of a time and that sort of a world, and then they would actually build that into the set. It's
insane.
Incredible.
I saw for the making of Cirith Ungol, they actually had like a defense mechanism and a defense system in place for like if someone was to attack the Cirith Ungol, there would be these like boulders that would like roll down and like crush the enemy, and they were like, yeah, this isn't going to be used
like
at all.
Indiana Jones kind of thing, like.
That you'd have to run away from.
We built the Temple of Doom outside Cirith Ungol just in case.
but it was incredible that the guys that designed the set were like, yeah, this isn't going to be used for any set piece or anything, we're just, you know, it'll be a nice little thing if anyone was to pick up on, but no one does.
Yeah. A lot of it maybe is kind of also even just to get the actors and all the extras almost into the mindset of their characters,
yeah.
Like for them to believe more like they're in this area. It kind of, when you were speaking about the amount of detail that's shown in those extra scenes and in those behind the scenes DVDs, there's so much, and it kind of reminded me a little bit of the making of The Mandalorian, where if you watch those, there's, again, they do like a full series on the making of The Mandalorian season 1 and season 2, and they have, I don't know, like 10 episodes in each.
I think it's 8. I think it's one, like nearly one per episode, yeah.
Sorry, I can't remember how many episodes, but they have, yeah, like basically one per episode almost. And there in those things as well, they give you so much detail. And I remember one specifically where they're speaking about working in this room where basically the whole wall is like, you're in a room where it's 360 degrees circular room, and all of the wall is a screen where you can project the background onto the walls. And one of the actors was saying how this was an incredible advantage because when they were shooting a scene where they were in a boat together and they were sailing down this like little river, a river of lava, of course, because it had to be dramatic. And
Mount Doom.
They said that like when they're looking off into the distance, normally if you're on set and you're with your co-actors, when you're looking off into the distance, you're probably imagining something in your mind, and you're trying to act on what you're imagining, and then you're hoping that your other actor, your co-worker, has a similar idea in their mind of what you're seeing. But he said that when you have this advantage of you're all looking at some projected image, and so it's just, you know, that everybody's on the same page in that kind of area. So just when we were saying there about maybe for the actors getting into the mindset of being in this area with all these like you know, booby traps around Cirith Ungol. Maybe that's another part of it as well, so that when you're acting and all of your extras, they all know it, they can all see what's happening and they all feel like they're part of this world.
That room, I was trying to think of it there, is the volume, but
the volume.
You should definitely watch the behind the scenes if you haven't seen that, because I don't know, I love watching behind the scenes for any movies. But the amazing thing about these movies is that the design team on Lord of the Rings had in mind the way characters dressed, moved, the colors they wear, the shapes on their weaponry and armor should reflect their culture. So they wanted to have it so that if you looked at a piece of architecture, you would know straight away if it's dwarven or elvish or whatever. So design usually reflects the characters themselves. So dwarves would be very rigid, sturdy, like stone, whereas elves would be fluid, lyrical, and elegant, like leaves and nature. And their style of weapons would be samurai-esque and all that kind of jazz.
Yeah, and just the style of their writing script as well. Just like
exactly.
Lots of like long curved lines and kind of flowing, and it's kind of like they're flowing clothes, and they're like in the very opening scene during the prophecy when they're fighting in the battle, and you see all the elves in formation and they're all with those huge long curved swords and they swing them all up at the same time. That's like the perfect introduction of this is what the elves are like. They have these like really elegant
so fluid
and they're all just so in sync and coordinated, and it's like everything that the elves do is kind of like a beautifully coordinated dance. They're all just ballet professionals, and like Black Widow.
And they turned that up to 11 in The Hobbit as well.
A quest to reclaim a homeland and slay a dragon.
That was another thing I didn't really put into this episode of the podcast, because it's a whole other thing. You can, like, we touched on the languages of different races and such, but the comparisons...
Did you get permission to touch them?
I did.
Okay, well then it's all right. Don't be touching them.
But the languages. So like what you said, the elves would have a very beautiful language, which is based on Finnish, and it's even the writing style is all like long and curvy and lovely. But then the dwarves have like all straight lines, and it's very like, I think it's like Hebrew. So everything is like a line here, line there, and the way they speak as well is like ishkakwi. It's not like. Exactly.
Yeah, I love the Dwarvish. I can't remember. I'm sure you probably remember the name of the Dwarvish language.
Kuzdul.
Kuzdul.
Yeah.
Kaza
Kuzdul.
I nearly had it. Kuzdul. Yeah. I really like the style of Kuzdul as well. The way the runes look when they're written.
Yeah.
And they're just. Like, I mean, they're so different from the Elvish style and the...
And again, they're basically taken from Nordic ruins as well, like Norse gods and all that kind of crack.
Like, but what I was saying is that they're so different, but I think that they're just equally as cool.
Yeah.
In just a totally different way. And just the style of, like, the helmet that Gimli wears, it's just such, like, a square kind of thing just, like, shoved onto his head. Like,
yeah.
And... it's cool when you see them. Again, you probably see a lot more of them in The Hobbit, where we get to see the dwarves actually in formation and things like that as well. And they have those kind of like their shields, and they're like, it's a completely different style to the elves, but it's again equally as cool.
And it's so recognizable, which would be like which is really cool. So they definitely achieved that on the set of the films.
They're taking the hobbits to Isengard!
Just to finish up, I've just... two or three more things to say, just to mention. So Bree, based on the Middle Ages England, with crooked architecture, depressing and leaning over the streets, and it's just muddy and awful.
Oh, that's cool. I am, man, when you say that, it makes me think about I don't know, just some books by maybe Roald Dahl, where the illustrations are kind of these kind of crooked old men, kind of like tall and like not really in proportion with reality, and
exactly
like really tall and skinny and bent over,
leaning over and warped,
with like a kind of a long shadow of something like that's kind of I can imagine Roald Dahl or whoever did the illustrations for his books, I can imagine that illustrator like doing the initial ideas for the drawings of Bree. That would be really cool.
So there you go. You also have Isengard, which is based on a Gothic aesthetic. We have Rivendell, which is actually slightly Celtic and based on a center of learning and museums and libraries and all that crack, built in among the trees like Lothlorien. And finally, I just had to put it in, the imagery of Saruman addressing the Uruk-hai is straight out of Hitler addressing the Nazis.
Yeah, that's so cool as well. Just this, like, I love that scene where he comes out the first time when he addresses them with Wormtongue.
Yeah.
And just like they walk out and the wind hits them, and a worm tongue. He just gets hit in the face with like this big, huge like gust of wind, and his hair is coming back, and you can just see he's got this like shock on his face, and just this amount of this number of Uruk-hai that is just this countless number that he couldn't imagine, and he's just like, yeah, the imagery is so strong there, and like, yeah, as you said, it really evokes the strong speech of Saruman is like quite similar and quite it's just taken right out of like a scene of Hitler giving a speech to his men. And rabbling up the crowd.
No, I think it's cool how Tolkien kind of, you know, he had the voice of Saruman. He was supposed to be like a real influential, like political leader almost. And then Jackson got the inspiration of Hitler for Saruman in that speech. And it's kind of funny how it's on the nose that he's supposed to be a very powerful, inspirational political leader with propaganda. And then here we go. We've got the perfect comparison with Hitler. And then you've got the Uruk-hai with their pikes, look very much like the Nazis holding up their flags and swastikas. So, evil. We don't condone Saruman and his Uruk-hai at all.
Yeah, exactly. Although we don't want to hurt the feelings of any of our Nazi friends that are out there listening to the podcast.
I did not see that coming. So this is a topic that is subjective, as some people would disagree with the fact that Tolkien had any inspiration from these things, but it is one that fascinates me and I'd love to know more. So, not just from Tolkien, but also from Jackson's inspiration. So please let us know if you know any extra little nuggets of detail and send them all in.
Send in some nuggets.
Chicken nuggets.
Some McDonald's nuggets.
Yes, please. Well, that's all from us on this week's episode of The Council of Elrond. Do you have any other parallels or symbolisms in both Tolkien and Jackson's Middle Earths? Or have we missed any? We'd really love to know more, as this is a topic that really interests us. You can get in touch with us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. If you are enjoying these podcasts and want to help us out, please leave a 5-star rating and review on your platform of choice. Thank you so much for listening, and we'll see you next week.